Hey everyone, Shabby M here, and welcome to part number two of our Fast Lane pay-per-view. Of course, if you've not seen part number one, it was uploaded last night. It was a pretty damn good show, actually. What was it? We had five matches on there. I can't remember what the matches were now. Did we start things off with... I think we started things off with the Vaude Villains versus American Alpha for the SmackDown Live Tag Team Championships. We also had Sasha Banks versus Paige, Apollo Crews versus Dolph Ziggler for the Intercontinental Championship, Noam Dar taking on Brian Kendrick for the Cruiserweight Championship, and I feel like there was one more match on there as well. I can't remember what it was now. And we've also got five matches set for you in this part of the video. This match here is a little bit of a surprise one, one we were not originally expecting. Austin Aries, of course, won the Royal Rumble. Now, he has issued an open challenge to anybody in the back so he can continue building his momentum towards WrestleMania. So it'll be very interesting here to see who takes up this open challenge. But also got some more big, big matches for you in this second part of our Fastlane pay-per-view. Of course, we're going to start things off with this one. And before I get into the rest of it, let's just see who is going to be facing off against Austin Aries here. Oh, Austin Aries, you may have just bitten off a little bit more than you can chew here, as here comes Randy Orton. Of course, Orton not booked to this pay-per-view at the moment, taking the opportunity to get himself on the card. And he also has the opportunity here to defeat the Royal Rumble winner, the man who is guaranteed to main event WrestleMania in 4 weeks' time. And what a massive win that would be for Randy Orton. A bit of a scalp for him, and it might just work his way higher up the card and, of course, get himself a match at WrestleMania. But yeah, talk about this. What's coming up in this video. We've got this match. Then we've got the New Day taking on the Dudley Boyz for the Raw Tag Team Championships. Becky Lynch defends her SmackDown Live Women's Championship against Trish Stratus. We have got the cage match that we made now. It's going to be Eric Rowan versus Luke Harper. And if Luke Harper wins that match, he will get his hands on Bray Wyatt one-on-one at WrestleMania. And then finishing off this video is going to be Finn Balor versus Kane. Demon versus Demon. Which one of those two is going to come out on top of that? And you're not going to want to miss that match. I'll tell you that for now. That is going to be very, very interesting. But I think all these matches have a lot of potential, actually. And this one here, starting off between Randy Orton and Austin Aries, could potentially be a very top-class match. Let's see what happens. As the bell goes and we are underway. Of course, like I said, Austin Aries, we've not really seen him a lot in the ring so far. Of course, he won the Royal Rumble, eliminating Roman Reigns at last. And that's guaranteed in the place at WrestleMania. He'll be facing off against the winner of our main event tomorrow, one of our main events tomorrow, which, of course, is going to be AJ Styles versus Samoa Joe for the SmackDown Live World Heavyweight Championship, which is going to be a very, very interesting main event at WrestleMania, isn't it, really? A very TNA-based main event as well, no matter what happens. Even Ring of Honor-based main event, if you want to look at it that way. And, of course, Randy Orton has been a little bit anonymous so far in this universe, but he's had his opportunities, but he's not really brought much from it. I'm not going to get involved in trying to recreate real life with having Orton joining the Wyatts. Of course, we've only got 4 weeks left until... I say 4 weeks, I've already said that we're probably going to get everything finished now by the end of the year, and we're going to start our fresh new year with brand new universe mode. I don't know, I'm thinking of trying to get this all finished. It's not going to happen, is it? I was going to try and get this all finished by Christmas Day, but I really don't think it's going to happen. But I think at the latest, I want to get the very final part of WrestleMania uploaded on New Year's Eve, and then we can start our new universe mode as of New Year's Day, probably. That'd be nice. Get a little bit ahead of myself. I've got some time off work. Why not? Austin Aries now stamping on the arm of Randy Orton. So, of course, like I was saying, Austin Aries is really looking for an extra bit of momentum here, and a massive win over Randy Orton on this pay-per-view would really help him out going forward into his big match at WrestleMania, of course. Randy, oh, looked like he was going to go for an RKO there, and Austin Aries managed to force him away. Aries now bringing Orton into the middle of the ring, and there's a Saito suplex folding Orton in half. Now slamming the arm of Orton into the ring. God, my computer chair is so squeaky, isn't it? Autumn fighting back, but Aries taking him down. Aeroplane spin there by Austin Aries. Not the sort of thing you expect to see from Austin Aries, but there he goes. Good nonetheless, I suppose. Aries now front chancery. Has both arms of Randy Orton hooked and a butterfly suplex and both of Orton's legs hit against that top rope. And now Aries 450 with an extra rotation in there as well. One, two. Oh, it's on the brink of three, but not quite enough. Aries now bringing Orton middle of the ring. Underhook, snap, suplex. And now Aries here. Oh, locking the last chancery. Beautifully, right in the center of the ring as well. Locking in that submission hold. Is it going to be enough? It is. Randy Orton gives in. And Austin Aries, a massive victory for him. That is going to really boost his momentum going forward into the WrestleMania pay-per-view in a few weeks' time. What a win for Austin Aries. And he also got Randy Orton to tap out as well. That's not something that a lot of people have ever done. Great win here for Austin Aries and a great way to start off the second part of our Fast Lane pay-per-view. And here is our second match of this episode. It is going to be the Raw Tag Team Champions on the line. Championships on the line. As Xavier Woods and Big E defend those championships against the Dudley Boys. And of course, old Kofi Kingston, along with Francesco, I would imagine, is going to be at ringside for this one. Cleveland, Ohio, we're doing well. At least it's sticking to the same place for every match at the moment. Now, of course, the Dudley Boys did win this number one contendership when they defeated somebody. Who did they defeat? Was it the club, maybe? They may have defeated the club, I think. And they already have plans for both tag team championships at WrestleMania. I'm looking forward to it. I've got another tag team match in my mind for WrestleMania as well. I've got some really, really good stuff planned in for you. We've sort of gone a little bit fantasy booking, shall I say, from the beginning of the universe up to the Royal Rumble was very much realistic. As soon as it hit the Rumble, we went more fantasy. We're bringing up extra people, we're bringing in some legends for the Legends Rumble, and of course bringing in the extra NXT guys. And then as we're going to go from Fastlane up to WrestleMania, it's going to get that little bit more sort of fantasy booking, I imagine. And you're going to see a lot of things that I'm hoping you guys want to see as well, but the things that I definitely want to see. So we're going to have some real interesting dynamics coming for you. And there will be some more people at WrestleMania that are not currently in our shows. So that gives you a slight hint maybe at what was going to happen. And some of it will be built up from this evening. So there are some important matches tonight, and you may not see the links yet. Obviously, I do, because I know what's going to happen in the future. But there's a lot of stuff happening tonight, which is really going to be the first step, or even not necessarily in the first step, maybe like the second or third step on the line to a big feud at WrestleMania. So it's going to be interesting, of course. The one thing we are going to know by the end of this evening is what our WrestleMania main event is going to be. We know it's Austin Aries. I keep saying this evening. When I say this evening, I mean across the entire pay-per-view, because I'm recording this all in one go. So yeah, we know Austin Aries is going to be there, but it's going to be either AJ Styles or Samoa Joe to join him. And then from that, we will continue to build up. WrestleMania at the moment, I've got about 15, 16 matches on WrestleMania at the moment. So it might end up being across 4, maybe even 5 videos, depending if I add any extra matches to it. So it's going to be a massive, massive pay-per-view, but there are going to be some really good matches on there. And like I said, a lot of it's going to end up being a little bit fantasy booking wise, but some good realistic stuff in there as well. So I'm hoping you guys are going to like it. I'm hoping I'm not going too far out the box, but you know. New Day Rocks. So one thing we did find out recently with the New Day is that when you do have Xavier Woods at ringside, he does have the trumpet with him, which is it's an extra little dynamic. There's little things like that that I didn't think the game did. And it's quite good, actually, because it gets the crowd going as well. And you see he's actually got the trumpet in his hand right now. So that's what it's all for, of course, the Raw Tag Team Championships. The New Day have been champions since day number one of this Universe mode. And there's the guys, one of the most experienced tag teams in wrestling history, I suppose, the Dudley Boys. Multiple times, I'm sure it's more than 20 time tag team champions now across all different companies. And that includes IWGP Tag Team Championships, WWE Tag Team Championships, ECW Tag Team Championships, TNA, WWE. They've had everything, haven't they? Everything that's worth having, they've had. And they've also had a lot more on top as well. And there's the New Day just gradually gyrating. New Day rocks. New Day rocks. Now, I did have another idea. I don't know whether... Do we class Kofi Kingston as a cruiserweight? I don't know, what do you guys think? Do you class Kofi Kingston as a cruiserweight? Because I'm thinking about different, obviously, tag teams to have in our 205 Live. And I don't want to bring in too many tag teams that are going to be deemed as unrealistic. I want to try and keep it as realistic as we can. But if we class Xavier Woods and Kofi Kingston as a tag team, the New Day could go for the Cruiserweight Tag Team Championships. Of course, we've got the Lucha Dragons. We've got the Bollywood Boys. And having those would be a really good third team. I'd like to have maybe four or five teams. We've got DIY. So if we did use Kofi Kingston and Xavier Woods as a tag team in our Cruiserweight Tag Team Division, of course, Big E would not be involved in 205 Live at all because he's obviously a bit on the heavy side for that. But it would mean we would have that extra tag team, which would be pretty useful as well, actually. Like I say, we've got the Bollywood Boys, we've got DIY, and we've got Lucha Dragons, and to have the New Day there as well would give us four teams, which I think would be okay. But of course, there's obviously more scope to bring in other people as well, other tag teams. I don't mind bringing in one or two. There's one that I think is quite realistic that we could do that might even join WWE this year. Obviously, the Young Bucks recently signed another two-year deal with Ring of Honor, so they won't be signing with WWE for a very long time. But we could. We'll wait and see what happens. I want to try and... I like the idea of going a little bit more fantasy, but at the same time, I want to keep it in the realistic realm. So there are tag teams out there that do not have contracts or contracts expiring this year that could sign with WWE. We probably will use them rather than the Young Bucks. Of course, we will use the Young Bucks at some point if we go into a Ring of Honor / New Japan Universe mode at some point, maybe. Which I would like to do. I'm just a little bit worried about my knowledge of New Japan. I know a lot of it, but I don't know a lot of it, if that makes sense. I know a bit, but not a lot, probably, if that's probably a better way of putting it. Yeah, I don't want to get in there and obviously there's probably a lot of people out there that have more knowledge on New Japan than me. Maybe I could just go off and do a full-on cruiserweight one. A full-on independent one, maybe. You see Xavier Woods now just stomping on the chest of D-Von. Bubba was distracting the referee. And now multiple tags here between Big E and Kofi Kingston. And poor old D-Von Dudley has taken an absolute brutal beating back there. And a drop kick in the corner by Big E. And New Day so far have dominated this match. There's the pin. It's only enough for a one count, but both Bubba and Kofi came in just in case. Yeah, I like the idea of having Kofi and Xavier Woods in the tag team division of, even the singles division of our 205 Live. Again, it adds some extra elements. Now, of course, we've got all our normal cruiserweights anyway, but having those extra guys in there just going to add a bit more star power to it. And it wouldn't surprise me if some point they do bring Xavier Woods into the cruiserweight division. It would make sense if New Day went for a sort of like divide and conquer idea where the New Day would obviously have the tag team championships, maybe Xavier Woods would go for the Cruiserweight Championship, or Kofi Kingston would go for the United States Championship, or even Big E would go for the United States Championship, and then try and hold that extra bit of gold, which is sort of like what The Shield did a couple of years ago when The Shield were tag team champions, and of course Dean Ambrose was United States champion. Big E big clubbing blow against the back of Bubba Ray, and I tell you what, the New Day have absolutely demolished the Dudley Boys here. But we know the Dudley Boys are vastly experienced wrestlers. We know they can turn a match around in absolute no time. As New Day just forcing Bubba back in to the ropes now. Two count only. Big frog splash to the back there by Kofi on Bubba Ray as well. New Day continue the assault, and I don't remember either Dudley Boy getting at any aggression at all. And even when Bubba does try and get any aggression like that, just straight away Kofi gets back in control. Kofi now monkey flip out the corner. Devon's on the ring, but it's not enough as Kofi hits that crossbody. One, two, only a two count. I love the way that Big E just run from one place straight to the other side of the ring and then just got straight out the ring again. That was a bit pointless there by Big E. I actually have notes on this match. That's what it is. Yeah, the Dudley Boys defeated the Club in a number one contendership match on Raw a few weeks ago. Bit of a surprise. It happened on both, didn't it? I put the Club up against the Dudley Boys on Raw, hoping the Club would win because I really want to see them against the Dudley Boys at Fastlane. And then I put the Vaude Villains up against TM61 over on SmackDown for the same reason. The Vaude Villains won. So I can say I don't influence this game in any way. I let it play out the way it do. I don't get me wrong, there are certain people that I push because I'm a big fan of them, like Luke Harper and people like that. There is the big kick by Kofi Kingston, and that's enough. Devon didn't even come in the ring to try and break it up. And the New Day once again successfully retain their tag team championships. New Day rocks. There was absolutely no Francesca business on the outside by Xavier Woods this time, was there either? But in fairness, I'm not surprised they kept their championships. They dominated this match from start to finish. And the Dudley Boys never looked like they were ever going to get in this one, did they? So it's a great win here for the New Day. And their championship reign continues once again. Just like in real life where they recently broke the record. However, they could lose the belts this weekend. It's Roadblock this weekend, isn't it? They could lose the belts there against Cesaro and Sheamus, which I think I'd like to see. I think they've held them for a very long time now, and I'd like to see a little bit of a refresh. And here is our next match of the evening. Of course, Becky Lynch defending her SmackDown Live Women's Championship against Trish Stratus. Very interesting match, this one. Of course, Trish won the 6th female over-the-top rope battle royal when she made her surprise return at the Royal Rumble. And this evening is a chance to get a hold of the gold. And there she is, championship in hand. Of course, she defeated Alexa... No, she never. She has defended the belt. I think it was against Alexa Bliss. A long time ago now. And then she obviously faced off against... Sasha Banks at the Royal Rumble in a champion versus champions match. And, of course, came out on top of that one against Sasha. But this is a different league, in all fairness. No disrespect to any of the other ladies, but Trish Stratus is a legend of the female division. And, yeah, this is going to be a very, very tricky one. This is going to be probably the biggest test of Becky Lynch's career. And probably the biggest match of Becky Lynch's career as well. There goes the bell and we are underway. Trish now with the neck breaker straight away. Very excited there, Trish. And straight into a backbreaker as well. And that's wrenching that back of Becky Lynch as well. Trish is not really known for her submissions, but after a start like that, attacking the back and now a big kick to the gut as well. Very aggressive side of Trish Stratus here this evening. Slamming the hand of Becky into the mat as well. Maybe Trish is just trying to neutralize any opportunity of a disarmer as well by doing damage to the arm. That's definitely a good way of trying to do that. But Becky now in control, taking some boots to the midriff of Trish Stratus herself. And Becky starts to work on the arm. Becky avoiding that knee to the back and now catching Trish straight away into a Bexplex and now over the top with that cutter as well. Oh, but Trish does fight back. Dropping an elbow into the chest of Becky and a kick to the back. Trish taking control once again with those elbows to the top of the head of Becky Lynch. And we did have quite a bit of talent to the female pool on SmackDown, didn't we, during the Royal Rumble. Not only Trish Stratus, but also Mickie James and also Asuka made their debuts, returns, whatever you want to call them, at the Royal Rumble. So I think leading up to the SmackDown Live Women's Championship match at WrestleMania, we're really going to have a lot of females fighting it out for that position. I have already said, I think on both Raw and SmackDown, we may be looking at some sort of multiple female match for that belt. There's these... Well, that's not the Stratus faction, is it? It's a Frankensteiner. Either way. Becky now getting behind Trish and dropping her onto the arm once again. And Becky's done a very good job here of consistently working over the arm of Trish. And now again with an arm breaker. And locking in that submission. I don't think it's quite a disarmer, but it's not far away. Didn't quite get enough on it, but she's definitely done a lot of damage on that arm. And I think if she can lock in that disarmer, it might just be enough to finish Trish off. Nice combination of moves there by Becky Lynch. Now bringing Trish back up to her feet. And again with a Bexplex, sending Trish flying across the ring. Becky lining Trish up. Let's hope for Becky's sake she's going to get her far enough away from the ropes. But Trish reverses that into a reverse DDT. Right hand to the gut. Dragging Trish in the middle of the ring. And once again, Becky with the arm breaker. Now straight into the pin. One, two. Only a two count. And Trish does kick out. This would be a humongous victory here for Becky Lynch if she could pull this off over Trish Stratus. But Becky is really starting to feel the crowd now. Maybe she should keep her attentions on Trish, though. You do not want to get caught out by Trish. And that can happen. And there we go. Right on cue. Trish taking Becky down. Vertical suplex, or a snap suplex, should I say, by Trish. And then drops a dropkick right into the face of Becky Lynch. That's her name. Brings her back up to her feet. Yeah, I'd like to see Asuka get an opportunity at WrestleMania as well, but Trish with a springboard bulldog, the Stratosfaction. That is the Stratosfaction, isn't it? I get confused with all of her moves. There's the pin. 1, 2. Brand new SmackDown Live Women's Champion. Trish Stratus wins the belt. Trish wins the gold. Where's the referee with the gold? Okay, we're not going to get to see Trish with the gold then. It's a strange one. This is what this was for the championship, was it? I may have buggered this up, people. I may have buggered this up. Either way, Trish will have the gold. And that's going to be interesting. It means that Trish Stratus has now just guaranteed herself a place on the WrestleMania card, defending that belt. But like I said, it will be a multi-person female match. So she's going to have some pretty difficult competition. I'm sure Becky's going to want to be in there as a rematch. I'm sure Asuka's going to want to be in there. You've got Mickie James, you've got Alexa Bliss, you've got Nikki Bella, you've got Natalia, you've got Carmella. There's so much talent now on the SmackDown Live roster here that I think that women's match at WrestleMania is going to be fantastic. And here we go. Eric Rowan versus Luke Harper. Luke Harper wins this match. He gets his hands on Bray Wyatt one-on-one at WrestleMania. No Eric Rowan, nobody else, just the two of them. And of course, this match is going to be a steel cage match, just to ensure that Bray Wyatt doesn't try and get himself involved in this match at all. I'd be interested now to see what WWE are going to do with Eric Rowan, because they brought Luke Harper on to SmackDown because Eric Rowan had become injured. The idea was originally for Luke Harper to be on Raw. Luke Harper obviously had to go back into SmackDown because his return from injury coincided with the injury suffered by Eric Rowan. Now they're sort of teasing the return of Eric Rowan. I saw a video yesterday of him getting himself a new mask, and it basically was a sheep mask like this, but it had clown face paint on it, which was pretty freaky. And I wonder whether they'll bring Eric Rowan back as a member of the Wyatt family, whether they might put Rowan on Raw, maybe on his own. I don't know. I have a feeling that Harper would do better on his own, and as we've seen recently, is Harper actually got himself in the main event on SmackDown last week, which was very good to see, because I'm a massive Luke Harper fan. And here he comes, the man, the myth, the legend. I'm a massive fan of Luke Harper, I really am. And that's why I really wanted to push him into the singles match at WrestleMania. But of course, he's made it himself, really, with that, with what happened at the Royal Rumble, of course. If you didn't see it, what basically happened was Luke Harper was one of the first few guys in there. And then Bray Wyatt's music hit. Bray Wyatt came running in. And straight off the bat, just started attacking Luke Harper. It made no sense to anyone. You would have thought the Wyatt family would probably team together in the Royal Rumble. It only makes sense to try and prolong your time in there. But while Luke Harper's back was turned, Bray Wyatt attacked him and tried to eliminate him straight away, and eventually did go on to eliminate him. The cage comes down and we are underway. Now, I'm a little bit worried about this because I can't remember for the life of me on this game whether cage matches work now. If they don't, I'm hoping cage matches work. I'm sure they do. Is Eric Rowan, massive chokeslam on Luke Harper. So cage matches are, of course, escape win only, I believe, on this. It might actually be pinfall, I'm not sure. Obviously, on the older games, you used to be able to change the match types to how you wanted them, but at the moment, you can't really now. Harper, massive clothesline now, taking Eric Rowan down. I don't think the argument is necessarily between these two. I think that Harper needs to defeat Rowan to get his hands on Bray Wyatt, of course, and obviously Rowan is just doing what the Patriarch has told him to do, but I don't think there's actually any bad feelings between these two, but they're both quite vacant, aren't they? They both let their actions speak for them. Let's say Eric Rowan will do anything that that Bray Wyatt tells him at this point in time. And I think that's going to make it a bit more of an interesting match because both these guys are just going to go out there and just full-on abuse each other because of this. And Luke Harper, there we go, just abusing Eric Rowan by slamming his dome right into the ring. Rowan's back up, though, catching Luke Harper in a front chancery. Big elbow to the back of the head. And, of course, we still have some big matches coming up for you in this fast lane. Well, in this video alone, we do still have for you, after this match, of course, Finn Balor versus Kane. That's going to be our final match of this video. And then coming up tomorrow, around about dinner time again, same sort of time this video is uploaded, we are going to be seeing four more matches, including Daniel Bryan versus The Miz. And we're going to have... who else we got? And we've got Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns for the United States Championship as Eric Rowan tries to climb the cage. But Luke Harper joins him up there and pulls him down with that almost like a Russian leg sweep. Also tomorrow we have for you Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn for the Universal Championship. And of course, AJ Styles versus Samoa Joe for the SmackDown Live World Heavyweight Championship as well. Yeah. Luke Harper now taking the opportunity to get the crowd behind him, I suppose. I don't know who would be playing the face in this... in this storyline. I would imagine it would be Luke Harper. Two big brutes here. Now it's Eric Rowan's impressed me as well. I think all three of the Wyatt family, all four, I suppose, if you include Bray Wyatt. I don't know why they include Bray Wyatt in that, but all four of the Wyatt family have really impressed. I think Bray has just become a much more of a presence in the ring. His moveset wasn't bad anyway, but he's become more of a presence, more of a psychological presence in the ring with stuff like his spider walk and stuff like that. He really has become more sort of a storyteller in the ring. Luke Harper was always a very talented wrestler, as now he tries climbing the cage, and it looks like cage matches might be quite short on this game, as Luke Harper is up top and does escape the cage very, very quickly. And Luke Harper has won this match. And he is going on to face off against Bray Wyatt at WrestleMania. I must admit, I'm disappointed with that match. I was hoping for something a little bit more long-winded, but there we go. Cage matches have never been that fantastic on this game. It seems odd because last year you could win them because people kept getting up. But this year, obviously, from this, they look to be a lot quicker. But there we go. Luke Harper picks up the victory. He is now guaranteed his match at WrestleMania. So we now know one of our WrestleMania matches is going to be Luke Harper versus Bray Wyatt. Obviously, Eric Rowan, Braun Strowman, anyone else will be banned from ringside. And I'm thinking we might make it a gimmick match of some sort as well. Maybe adding some weapons into there. Maybe a tables match. I don't know. We'll have to give it a bit more thought. But let's get into our final match of this video. Of course, Kane versus Finn Balor. So here we go. Here is that final match of this video. Demon versus Demon. The Devil's favorite Demon, Kane, takes on the Demon King, Finn Balor. Where's that random music coming from? And here he comes. The devil's favorite demon, Kane. This feud, also, I don't even know who started this feud. It's difficult to really tell, isn't it? But it all came about when Kane was transferred from SmackDown over to Raw, traded for Cesaro. Raw were looking for some more experience in their roster, while Cesaro was looking for some more opportunity, and I think it has worked out better for both involved. And that sort of led to the whole argument here between Kane and Finn Balor. There was a couple of promos here and there which ended in a low blow. There was a backstage brawl which didn't end in too good stead for either of these two guys either. And it really was an interesting situation. But it looks like we are going to see the Demon King here, Finn Balor himself. In one of the longest entrances on the game. So I'm hoping you guys are sat down and looking forward to seeing a bit of this. And don't skip this entrance. And this is why. Just letting you take this in for a second. There we go, Finn Balor sporting a new attire here this evening. Trying to get in the mind of Kane by mimicking Kane by the looks of it. He's got the mask as well as a coat as well. When I found this, I thought, you know what, we've got to do this feud. Literally, this feud is solely down just to this one attire. And there's quite a lot of different Finn Balor attires. I found them on PS4. If you're looking for any, there are loads on there. I'm not going to give any more away because I might use some more. But if you want to go and have a look on PS4 yourself, there are quite a few alternative. Obviously, being Finn Balor, people have created a lot of really cool alternative attires for him. There's a lot of his ones he used to use on the indie scene, like is it Venom and Anti-Venom and the Joker and all these sort of ones that he used quite a lot. And there's obviously quite a few that people have made sort of like hints to other wrestlers, and this one of course being the one to Kane. So Finn Balor, by harnessing the inner demon of himself and Kane in one, that's going to make him a lot more dangerous here, isn't it? And this match is going to be Extreme Rules. Look at Kane. He looks as shocked as anyone else by just what Finn Balor is wearing here. I told you this is one of the longest entrances I've ever seen in my entire life, isn't it? Can you imagine how good this guy is going to be at WrestleMania when he gets his full-on WrestleMania entrance? The thing is, they do a big thing for him in his normal sort of entrance for normal pay-per-views. Can you imagine? Because they always like to go over the top and give people special WrestleMania entrances, and I'm sure this guy is going to be one of them. Of course, if you've never seen it before, his entrance at Wrestle Kingdom 9, I may get the numbers completely wrong, but Wrestle Kingdom about 2 or 3 years ago, where he first sort of got notoriety for wearing his different attires and his paint and stuff like that. And he was brought down to the ring in a coffin, which was quite an interesting way of doing it. But straight away, Kane is the one taking the control early match. And of course, this is billed as Demon versus Demon. The Devil's favorite Demon, Kane, versus the Demon King, Finn Balor. Balor there with the jawbreaker on Kane. And a sit-out scoop slam. And Kane's leg caught the middle rope as well. That's a chance there for Kane to pick up an ever so slight injury, maybe. As Balor continues the assault with the elbow drops. Now slamming the arm of Kane into the ring. Kane sweeping the legs of Finn Balor. And now Kane making his way to the outside. Kane maybe looking for some, a little bit of help maybe. Kane is underneath the ring, but of course Finn Balor is right behind him. Pretty poor decision by Kane there to try and retrieve a weapon while Finn Balor was stood right behind him. Of course, he was never going to let him do so, was he? Knee drop to the face. And of course, like I said, this is Extreme Rules. So no countouts, no disqualifications, but all pinfalls must take place within the ring. There's also no rope breaks as well. So should one of these two guys try a submission hold, it will count. Kane does have a kendo stick, but Finn Balor with a big right hand just knocking Kane down. Kendo stick drops. Finn Balor and Kane now fighting into the timekeeper's area. Oh, Finn Balor runs straight into a big boot there from Kane. Finn Balor back up now, going for a regal plex. Oh, Kane gets dropped on the back of his neck outside. Finn Balor, DDT again on the outside by the timekeeper's area. One thing this game hasn't done too much is announce tables. Last year's game, the announce table was quite a big thing. People always going through it, but this year's game doesn't seem to be the same. Kane now dropping Finn Balor as the fight continues on the outside. These two guys really up for this one. Both, of course, wanting to prove that they are the best demon in the WWE, the only demon in the WWE. Finn with the sling blade on the outside. And stamping on the arm of Kane as well. Of course, like I said, pinfalls and submissions only count inside the ring. So if anyone does hit some sort of high impact move on the outside, it's not really going to help them too much. Kane belly to belly slam. And now Kane continues to look for some weaponry, and he does have that kendo stick. Kane's looked for that weaponry quite a lot so far. Finn has not gone for it. Oh, but Finn does get it now, straight across the back by Kane. And now Kane just brutalizing the ground of Finn Balor, but Balor's back up, catching Kane with that right hand, but Kane straight away again with the boot to the gut. See, this for me is very much a youth versus experience situation. But then again, Finn Balor is very experienced himself. He hasn't been wrestling for anywhere near as long as Kane, of course. Kane's been going now for 20 years, 25 years, something like that. 20 years. Didn't he debut in like 96 or 97? 96, I think it may have been. Kane diving elbow drop, taking Finn down. Two. Only a two count there. Kane now slitting his own throat there. Bringing Finn Balor up, but Finn was playing possum, catches Kane with the jawbreaker. Now taking Kane up. Oh, into a brainbuster. Finn now drops to the outside. Maybe Finn's going to be looking for a little bit of assistance in this match as well. Let's see what Finn pulls out. What's he got there? He's got a baseball bat. That baseball bat seems to compress down to absolutely nothing, but Kane wrenching that baseball bat away from Finn Balor. Oh, Finn just about avoids being hit in the forehead with it as well. And Kane rips it back off Finn Balor. You can't beat the old reversal weaponry. That happens quite a lot in this game, doesn't it? Kane now sending Finn Balor back into the ring. Big clubbing blow and a boot to the side of the head of Finn Balor as well by Kane. Kane sliding back in now. Brings Finn back up to his feet and now just almost just choking Finn Balor out, just crunching his face. It's almost like a mandible claw, just not in the throat maybe. And Kane just does not... Oh, Finn now finally just forced Kane off. Kane with another big strike. There's one thing that Finn doesn't want to do is get into a striking battle with Kane or get chokeslammed by Kane. There's the pin. One, two. Oh, and Finn Balor kicked out the chokeslam by Kane. Kane cannot believe it. But Finn is still in this one. Kane drops into the corner. Drops into a pin once again. I can't imagine it's going to work this time, Kane. If it didn't work last time. No, Finn Balor kicks out once again. But Kane's allowing Finn a long time there to sort of lay on his back and regain a bit of energy. Kane, big overhand punch. Now reverse DDT on Finn Balor as well. Again with a pin. One, two. And again, Finn Balor kicks out, this time more aggressively. And Kane is really struggling to finish the Demon King off here. Obviously, Kane does have the experience. I can't imagine he's going to get too frustrated. He'll keep his eye on the game. He knows what he needs to do. Or does he? He's already chokeslammed him once. Again, only a two count. Kane cannot believe it at the moment. Kane now going to the outside of the ring. Looking like he might need a little bit of help to try and finish Finn Balor off. But again, for every moment that Kane is outside the ring, looking for some help to finish Finn off, that's allowing Finn Balor an opportunity to recuperate. And Finn now is back up on his feet, comes to the outside and wrestles the ladder away from Kane and catches Kane right in the face with the ladder. Stamping on the arm of Kane now, and Finn is struggling. You see him keep clutching his head. He's taken quite a lot of big hits so far. And of course, like we know, Kane is a very aggressive striker, just like his brother, The Undertaker. Both of them, you don't really want to get into a striking war with, do you? Finn now bringing Kane back up to his feet once again and sends him straight into the ring post. And again, Finn sending Kane face first into the ring post. That's a good camera angle, that, isn't it? For especially, I like this camera angle, especially in obviously AI versus AI matches that we're spectating. Finn sending Kane into the ring. Big elbow across the face as well. Kane playing possum, taking Finn down with an arm breaker. Drops into the pin once again. Kane going for the pin whenever he gets the opportunity. And again, Finn kicks out. And again, Kane on his way to the outside. Again, looking for some help here to try and finish Finn Balor off. Kane now with a table. Be interesting to see if they try and actually put each other through the table, because I've had this before in previous games where they end up using the table as a blunt weapon rather than actually using it for its original use. I think that would be a good idea for WWE if they did do that. And again, Kane just squeezing the head of Finn Balor, forced him down onto the ground. This is a submission hold. The referee is there. And can Finn Balor wrestle his way out of this? It's been a pretty good match so far. I'm really enjoying this, actually. Real back and forth between two dark individuals. Finn now has Kane in the front chancery. Of course, Finn has already survived a chokeslam. Finn now wrenching the arm of Kane back, and again wrenching the arm by weakening the arms. That's going to really reduce the amount of damage Kane can do from strikes. And of course, a chokeslam. Finn on his way to the top. Kane is positioned on top of that table. Finn, there's the coup de grace into the pin. One, two, and three. There we go. Finn Balor picks up the victory over Kane in the battle of Demon versus Demon. It is the Demon King, Finn Balor, who comes out on top. And somebody has erected the table. I don't know how that happened. But a great victory there for Finn Balor. And I really enjoyed this match, actually. It wasn't high-flying and spectacular, but at the same time, it was a good hard-fought battle from both guys, and it was a good back-and-forth as well. How Finn survived earlier on when he got caught with the chokeslam and several other high-impact moves, I'll never know. But here we go. Finn Balor does pick up the victory over Kane, and that is going to put him in great stead moving towards WrestleMania. So, of course, guys, that is the end of part number two of Fastlane. I hope you have enjoyed it. Of course, if you have, it'd be great if you could hit that like button for me. It does really help me out. And of course, if you are new around here and you have enjoyed what you've seen, then please do hit that subscribe button as well. Of course, if you've not seen it already, you can check out part number one of Fastlane. It will be the previous video to this in the playlist, which can be found in the description below. And also, of course, keep your eye out for tomorrow when the final part of the Fastlane pay-per-view will be uploaded. Four more matches for you. We will have, what have we got? We've got Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns for the United States Championship. We have got Finn Balor, I'm just looking at him. We've got Daniel Bryan versus The Miz one-on-one. And we have, of course, the two big championship matches. Sami Zayn defending his Universal Championship against Kevin Owens. And AJ Styles defending the World Heavyweight Championship against Samoa Joe. So I've been Chabby Gamer. Thank you very much for watching. And I'll see you all tomorrow for our final part of our Fastlane pay-per-view.